All right, thanks everybody for coming, and thanks for those watching live or recording on HCAM. My name's Joe Markey, on the Elementary School Building Committee, and this is actually our fourth workshop. The previous three helped us get to town meeting, where town meeting approved the acquisition of some land where we're going to build a new school. And the purpose of this forum is to talk about what is going on inside the school and what might the school look like. So sharing some preliminary design work. And then the from Superintendent McLeod and Principal DeVoe sharing kind of what the educational program is inside the school. So it's great because I don't really have a whole lot else to say, and they're going to carry the rest of the next 90 minutes or so. So welcome and thanks for your participation. And I'll hand it over to Jim and Kathy and team. Thank you.
So welcome. This is an intended visual where you see us working side by side with the architects, because that's exactly what it's been over the past several months. And we really wanted a chance to have a conversation with you tonight about the educational program and how it's going to be realized in the building. And so our thought was to talk about the vision, the program, and then let you see what does it look like with real kids in spaces doing the kind of work that we're going to talk about with you tonight, and then project into the future about how it could look potentially in a new space. And so we've been working closely on putting this together for you, and really I'm beginning by talking about what our vision is. The vision that we've had from the very beginning of this project is to think about a space where our youngest learners are together. Right now our preschool program is housed in this building at the back in what used to be a cafeteria. I went there today and was talking with the director about a related matter, and I said to her, how long have you been here? And she said, it has been in this building for 14 years. She had been here for 12. And so to have our preschoolers to be part of a building where we can have preschool, kindergarten, and first grade is really important. Lauren and I both came to the district last year, so this is our second year here, and one of the first things we did together is to look at, what do you mean we can't provide full day kindergarten for every child who wants it? At that point, it was a lottery, and looking at, well, how can we find the space within the building to provide that option for all learners? So the vision is a consistent program where all children in our pre-K-1 population have access to an excellent educational program. So when we look at, that's the district vision, what is the early childhood vision and core values? So the purpose of early childhood has many facets. The first being early intervention. We want to address the needs of children early. If we address those learning needs early, the return rate later is incredible. We're closing the gaps, we're building solid foundations. We also want to provide differentiation. What that big word means, children might be very familiar with that, is we're giving children instructionally what they need. We're providing that instruction. Children are able to attain different skills and move on to different areas. So they're not all necessarily learning the same thing at the same rate as a whole group as you might have experienced when you were in school. Another aspect of that is intervention. So while we differentiate, we're meeting the needs of our lower learners, our average learners, and our exceeding learners. Intervention is we're providing more in an intervention manner for students that need a little bit more to get to that expectation or exceeding expectation. We also, the prevention model. If we are providing early intervention, we are preventing learning difficulties down the road and preventing any gaps. So here's an example of some small group differentiation. This is a small group writing kindergarten class. The teacher is working, she's providing one-on-one assistance, she's right there. There's some independence going on, but there's an example of what a small group activity looks like in kindergarten.
And before you move on from that slide, or it's fine, you might wonder, what are the other 15 children doing while that one teacher is only working with five? And that's part of the instructional model,
having centers for students who can work independently and building that independence right from the beginning with appropriate, age-appropriate activities for them to do. There may also be a paraprofessional working with a group of students, or it could be a co-taught classroom. So this is intentional. It provides directed instruction to those five children who needed it, where the others are being appropriately challenged in different centers across the room, and then the kids would rotate through.
And here's an example in a preschool classroom. So we also work on this with our youngest learners. When you have a group like this working, you might look and think they're playing, but play actually is work for our youngest learners. They're sharing, they're taking turns, they're building their language skills, they're building their vocabulary. So in addition to playing, they're exercising fine motor skills. There is a lot that goes into this activity. And we have another example. Again, this is a preschool class. We are beginning with some math concepts. We're taking out bear counters. They're graduated in size. We can sort by color. There's many activities that we can do. So here's a self-directed station. As Dr. McLeod talked, we had teacher-directed activities. And here is play with a self-directed activity that incorporates math and reasoning, which again is all part of that hands-on learning through play. So when we look at spatial relations, that's important when we talk about our new facility. We want to be able to maximize our adjacencies and how we can best use space. You saw those examples that might occur within one classroom. You have an area to work with students on writing. You have an area to work with math manipulatives. So we even are looking at expanding that when we're looking at other classrooms that we might share and have flexible grouping with. It's okay for teachers to work with students from other classrooms. If that's the skill that you're working on and you have a small group, we welcome that. We also look at areas in terms of shared space. We want less distance. We want to minimize our transition time. So really looking at how best we set up that space. But what's really key, and we'll have other pictures for you, is that flexible grouping and shared space. We really work on differentiating, again, meeting the needs of those individual learners, and that is varied grouping practices. Not necessarily within your own classroom, but almost a group of classrooms and neighborhood, which you'll see a little bit about.
Right now. Lauren promised pictures. My name's Jim Barrett. I'm part of the architectural team that is trying to be responsive to the educational program statement being waved over. As described by Superintendent McLeod and by Lauren, Judd Christopher is our project manager, working with us in terms of taking this information, descriptions of what works today in Hopkinton Public Schools, specifically in terms of early education, what works well, what are the things that we'd never want to see changed, and where are some of the constraints that currently exist that hopefully a new building can help us address. This sketch was something that we did early on in terms of thinking about what we were hearing, and it's really coming to an understanding of this is a young child's first experience in a rather large building, probably for many first time with others in a communal sense operating outside of their home. And trying to think about through a child's eyes, how does a large building like this come to be organized? And this thought was the classrooms actually form the neighborhoods, if you will. Going downtown might be heading out to the gymnasium or heading out to the library. Civic center might be administration, those types of things. So it's one way where in a young student's minds, the organization of a larger building can be something that's comprehensible. This is a sample of a plan diagram. And in thinking about it, the blue areas within this are those of the classroom spaces. But you can see that there are groupings of them organized into these neighborhoods. You see the purple zone here, that is administration, that is kind of that civic center, the heart of the building, if you will, the welcoming element to the facility. And then we have some larger scale downtown elements. We have the gymnasium, the cafeteria, upstairs a library space, all part of those kind of public setting spaces within the building. So that's a quick snapshot of a footprint of the building responsive to that issue and that idea of village and community.
So Lauren has talked, already mentioned flexible grouping a couple of times, and it really is something that's fairly new in education, actually, and we see it right through into high school. The idea is that your needs are going to change, and we expect them to. And just because you all start developmentally at the same place in September doesn't mean that by December you're going to have developed at the same time, at the same pace. We're very much aware of and using data to inform our grouping decisions so that we can really support students and their growth at their speed. So some students might come to us, for example, at the beginning of the year having already met kindergarten end of year benchmark. They could be reading at a first grade level. We want to continue that growth. Our expectation is at least a year's growth every year. So similarly, if they come below grade level, that's fine. You know, you are where you are, and we're going to work with you at your pace. So flexible grouping means that a group can start together and change over time. It also means that it can be skill-based. So it can be based on level, but it can also be based on skill. If I am a student that needs to work on beginning decoding skills, and somebody else in my classroom is working on fluency, there might not be anybody else in my class needing that instruction. But there could be somebody in the neighborhood who needs it. And so working flexibly with the principals, with the teachers, within the teams, means really looking at scheduling. We want to make sure that all children on that team, in that neighborhood, I should say, have literacy instructional blocks at the same time of the day. So that if we need to, some schools call it walk to read, if we need to walk to read and go next door and be grouped with similarly leveled students for that need, we can do that for a period of time, maybe 6 to 8 weeks for a half an hour during that literacy block. So we want to do that. We talk about doing within classrooms, between classrooms, both within a regular education setting and a special education setting.
So here's an example of the in-between classrooms. We do group, we use every nook and cranny at Center School when we're working on projects. So not necessarily ideal. We work on our group and we make space for it. But just this is an example of students working together that's perhaps in an area outside of their classroom, but a joint effort working collaboratively on something.
So in terms of thinking about how things work today, this is an example of meeting the need in a way that is successful, those students working comfortably out in the hallway space. This diagram begins to envision the new building and looking at a question of, can space be layered? So looking at the opportunity of finding a variety of types of spaces that might form an area. So here is a typical classroom environment. We've peeled off the lid of this portion of the building. This is that kind of five classroom cluster that we talked about as neighborhood. But you'll notice the types of spaces that are kind of between the neighborhoods. And it's a variety of layers of spaces, if you will. What you'll find in this is the corridor space actually can be widened and used as a place where you can have meetings, you can have gatherings, you can have students working comfortably, but not being directly in the middle of the corridor, kind of off to the side. You'll see another type of space here where we have a layering of space where for students that need a different type of control in terms of the environment can have a quieter space, one where there's less distraction, as yet another type of space. And outside the skin of the building, taking opportunity of the idea that education happens everywhere on the campus, so that bleeding through the skin of the building, if you will, the opportunity to have outdoor learning environments and outdoor learning opportunities as well. So this gives you an idea of it in a plan view, and you can see here's yet another one of those ideas of an outdoor learning space sized differently for larger groups of students, if you will. Ultimately, it all works around the classroom, and the classroom has to be, as are the other spaces, multi-layered and able to speak to a wide variety of needs. And we'll talk more about that as we go on.
So I
wanted to talk about early literacy. I alluded to it earlier on. We expect a developmental range, but we want to be able to somewhat control the developmental range in the sense of meeting kids where they're at. And if we have students coming to us with a wide range of instructional backgrounds, that's more difficult to do. So when we are thinking about our former first grade program, had students coming in with such a wide range of kindergarten experiences that it made it very challenging. It gave us only 1 year to get everybody where they needed to be and beyond, moving into the next building, the Elmwood School. So the idea of focusing on early literacy in an early childhood center, providing the kinds of instructional opportunities that we're talking about tonight, is going to put the district in a place where they are being preventative, as Lauren has said, reducing the needs for special education because the program will be stronger from the beginning, and being aware of the needs of our students from the very early years. And that's what the program is intended to do. We talk about, therefore, teaching literacy, so the focus on literacy, across the content areas. So in the educational program that we've described to the MSBA, they've said to us, you know, this is not a typical K-5 building. We want to understand your story. We want to understand how it is, what is the vision, and how is this different than what we might find in a K-5 building. Well, one of the biggest differences is that literacy is taught across the content areas. We don't stop instruction and say it's time for social studies. We don't necessarily even say it's time for math. It's fluid. We have literacy instruction taught in the math class. We have kids writing about math. We have kids learning math vocabulary, learning to read math vocabulary. The same thing across science. Science is embedded within literacy. Theme-based instruction, so that kids are applying their literacy skills, speaking, listening, writing, reading, across all of those areas. Do you want to add, Lauren?
Well, here's an example of literacy in action. There's a method that we'll often use to group our reading instructional block called Daily Five, where here's you have a teacher in the far corner working with students, and there are about 4 students at the table for a specific area of reading. So not only do we group by reading level, we group look at comprehension, we look at fluency. So there's a variety of ways to group for reading. You have students working on word work. You have students working on writing. So this is all in the course of a literacy block, if you will. So a variety of areas that children are able to move and manipulate. They're not sitting there with worksheets. They have items that they're moving to build words, write words, create. It really is an active environment, and this is a first grade class. So if this is first grade, you can imagine this is the same preschool and kindergarten as well. And this is, you think, how does that start? It doesn't start day one. It's a management piece. You teach children, what does it look like when you're at read to self? So it's building that stamina and that independence so that you can get to that multi-group program. Here's an example of a student working independently. We use bean bags. We use a variety of areas to sit and work. And the child's working on a writing piece there. Here is a teacher working on a Words Their Way lesson with 3 kindergartners. 3 are in that group because they're working on that specific phonics application of that Words Their Way program. And in the background, you can see other groups at tables. So gone are the days in terms of when we were in school, and you might envision the desks in the row, stagnant, you really didn't move much. There is a lot of movement in an early childhood classroom. We use the floor, we use a variety of options, and it really is fluid, and those groups are regularly changing based on what we know about students and their growth. And here's a child in a first grade classroom working independently and working on their spelling words, but building letters. So it's not just read and write down letters. We're building, we're changing them. We don't want children to just learn skills. We want them to apply and practice them, because then they own them, and that really contributes to a solid foundation. And so when you see, I'll let Jim speak to this, but when you see the different areas, this is why. This is why there are different nooks and crannies in a classroom for a pre-K-1 building.
Yeah, so this is a 3D model. I think Jim's going to go to the actual SketchUp model for it. So this is the 3D model of a typical classroom. This happens to be a kindergarten classroom. And what we were trying to do here is we've had the opportunity to see how the existing center school operates. And it's a lot about flexibility, as you've heard and you've seen in a lot of the slides. There's a lot of smaller group learning, even one individual type learning. So the classroom wants to be very flexible. So this is really done by a lot of movable furniture that the teachers can change on a week-to-week basis, on a day-to-day basis, depending upon the needs of the students that are being taught in that class. And again, here, this is a shot kind of looking into the entrance of a typical classroom. The front of the classroom would all have some storage, some even some casework, a sink. But the intent within the classroom itself is that there's a lot of movable furniture, which allows a lot of the flexibility that's needed for the teaching that will be going on in these classrooms. One of the other things you'll see in some of the early models that we've done is we're trying to maximize the amount of wall space. If you've gone to any of the classrooms in the existing center school, wall space is at a premium.
So when we're looking at how is it that we want our students to be motivated and engaged in learning, it is that hands-on application, that experience. A lot of that furniture that you saw is low open shelving. Children need to be able to access materials, access books, and be able to regularly have that independence and ownership to put away materials and take out materials. So while a teacher's area might be closed, cabinets, we want accessibility for students. This is their classroom. And something that's a challenge for us now, we incorporate multi-sensory aspects as best we can, but for those of you that are familiar with our setup, we don't have a sink in a room. Wow, that's terrific. When you're cleaning up with paint, it's a bit of a challenge because we do want to paint at our level. We should be painting. To have the ability to paint and clean up right there, get a little messy, we should still be able to get messy in a creative way, and we're looking to do that, have sensory sand, rice tables, and looking at incorporating other aspects. We have illustrations of letters and stamps. We're looking to even add more to enhance variety of those opportunities. Here's an example of a science center. It's wonderful, it's great, but it's really tight. We have children that are at tables behind, but these children were so just engrossed and excited about looking at starfish, shells from the beach, and using a magnifying glass, a tool. So they're learning this terminology, they have connections, many of them have been to the beach, they have seen shells like that, they're talking about different textures, and as I was trying to take the picture, you could see they're very excited, telling me all about it. We would like a little bit more space for that, a little bit more elbow room. Very tight. Here's an example of a first grade class, and they were working on a unit, and they were trying to direct a path of light. So here we had three children working, everyone has a job. So these groups were going on throughout the classroom. So we need space to be able to set up a project, an experiment, test it out. Children would go back and draw or write what happened, why it worked, why it didn't work. But they need to try, sometimes it might not work, and have that space to be able to rework a problem for that scientific process to come to a solution. Special education.
Yeah, we've talked a lot about this. You know, the ever-changing needs of students, the cooperative learning opportunity. I'm going to talk about what some of these things mean. So targeted interventions. When we're talking about targeted interventions, what we mean is that by using assessment data, we can determine exactly where a student needs assessment, in instruction, I should say. So it's targeted on the needs of that particular student, or there could be some similar needs of students that can be grouped accordingly. So when we're thinking about an inclusive environment, we want to be able to provide that kind of instruction within the regular classroom as much as possible. And that's why we are looking at a co-teaching model, for example. Is that what this is, Lauren?
It's a kindergarten classroom, but this is a classroom that has children with and without special needs.
Yeah.
They're taught together as much as possible.
And when we have an inclusive environment, one of the things, and I'll give you an example, it doesn't take very long for students themselves to figure out that, you know, they're not maybe learning the same way as maybe their classmates and that they're struggling. They know that they're struggling. And we unintentionally reinforce that fact by pulling them out of the regular classroom. And they have to go somewhere else to be taught. And then when they come back to the regular classroom, they've already missed
whatever the other kids were doing, it's very, very disruptive. So in an inclusive environment, students are taught within their classroom setting, either by having a special education teacher come in for that particular part of the student's day, as driven by the IEP, or are in an inclusive environment all day where we have two teachers who work, again, that word flexibility. I might be the special education teacher, but for this week, I'm going to be working with a group of students who are not special education students for this science project, let's say. And very soon, those labels disappear, and students are no longer, that self-fulfilling prophecy goes away. It truly does. We've seen it this year in fifth grade, where kids seamlessly go from one teacher to the other, and it's not like, oh, you're the special education teacher, so if I'm with you, that means I'm having trouble. No, we're just two teachers in a classroom that are supporting the kids, or it could be a teacher and a paraprofessional. So this inclusive environment is intended to give kids make them feel that they're part of the program and we're helping them to be successful, but it's also to take away, you know, that predetermined expectation that a teacher might have, that, oh, you have a learning disability, so my expectations for you maybe is not quite as high. And that's not what we want, right? We want high expectations for all students, targeted interventions that are meeting their needs when they need them, and inclusiveness so that all kids feel that they're part of the educational program. So you see, and kids are back and forth within this. It's not like we have kids grouped at certain tables.
So here's an example of a space where there are times children need a bit more in-depth, distraction-free, focused learning environment. This is an example of a special education area where students might come up with that specific, explicit, and direct instruction. Expectations are clear, materials are right there, but you can see this is a multi-shared space. We have storage, we have two teachers sharing this space. So the small group area for this leaves a lot to be desired, because what we want to do is provide the optimal learning environment for whatever that may be. Is it the small group flexible within the class? For children that do have a level of need that does require that out, our goal is to maximize that instruction so that then we can decrease that and move back to the inclusion practices.
Right, so what this plan shows is, while what we're talking about is special education be inclusive within the classroom, there are some times where we talked about targeted needs where they need to be in a smaller group setting. And those are really dispersed throughout the wing, so they're not sent off to another end of the building. They're within the main wing itself. As you can see up on the second floor, there are some smaller rooms where those would be the smaller targeted group sessions where kids can go, if like you said, they need a place where they can be a little bit more
focused, distraction-free.
Right? Right. They can have that there.
Sorry, could you just go back, because we wanted to also point out in this slide that the special education rooms are incorporated throughout the building. Right. Does that show on here?
Right. So if you look, you have the main, there's two what we call special education intensive rooms. There's one in the preschool wing, and then there's one that's kind of centrally located within the main wing itself. And then the smaller ones are kind of dispersed throughout the wing.
Okay, right. Great, thank you.
So it's important, you might think of when you were in school and you never saw children that participated in special education, they were isolated. We truly do have an inclusive environment. So not only is it for learning needs, at this level, children know who knows how to tie shoes already, who can draw and write their name in the lines. I mean, so we teach that acceptance and diversity for a variety of skills for the children that have strengths as well as areas that we're working on to strengthen. In some of these areas that are special education areas, at times they're accessed by typically developing children. We have children that benefit from body breaks, sensory breaks. When we were in school, something again, we probably sat and we were supposed to sit still all day. We know that movement actually helps us refocus, re-energize, and then again, we're starting with that maximum attention to learning. So we do have a variety of children that will use therapy spaces to get that large muscle movement, which then in return has greater academic gains. So it's key having these spaces where they're readily accessible to all children. Some of something else that we work on is building a sense of community with our students. As Jim mentioned, it's a very large building. When children are coming in, can be a bit overwhelming. They start first with their classroom community, then a group of neighboring classes that they might have some flexible grouping. There are times we are grouped by partial grade level, entire grade level, entire school. But all of that contributes to that sense of community. We implement the responsive classroom. That's a program where we have morning meeting, we're looking at grouping each other. So part of the floor plans that show to rug, in addition to those small group table areas, we also need an area where the entire class can congregate on the rug for stories, for morning meeting, for morning message. And also, we have an example of how we have grouped now. Here's an example of maybe 3 to 4 kindergarten classrooms enjoying a storyteller. So we do group together. We find nooks and crannies wherever we are able to do that now. But this is Len Cabral, wonderful storyteller and a great experience that our kindergartners experience. So we do work on providing community building experiences for various levels for children. Because even though they think they're here, we work on starting here you are, here's your class, here's your school. But at this level, they're so egocentric, they think that they're here. So trying to help frame that community goes a long way.
So in terms of the floor plan, we touched on this earlier, but that idea of clusters of classrooms together to form that neighborhood, being able to provide that fabric for the children to understand that there can be movement throughout these couple classrooms and group them together in an area that's understandable and can be made sense of. But as we touched on earlier, there's also kind of the interconnecting tissue, and those are the types of spaces that fall between those spaces, like these breakout spaces in the corridors, where larger groups, maybe 2 or 3 classrooms, can sit on the floor and have a storyteller actually utilize that area, or for larger groups, go out to the cafeteria or go out to the library, where larger spaces are available in the building for those types of activities.
Something else that we work on is building the capacity of our staff. They work together. They are grouped in what's called a professional learning community. And it might range from 3 classrooms, and it might be more than 3 teachers if we have a co-teaching situation, to 4 or 5 classrooms. They meet weekly. They meet to look at curriculum, units. They look at assessment and student data. It's a problem-solving collaborative team. Here's an example of a group of first grade teachers reviewing student writing, scoring assessments together, talking about next instructional steps. We need to work on topic sentence. What's a way we can incorporate that? What is that going to look like? So our teachers are regularly part of a professional learning community, and we look at having this continue, and obviously having a space that this can happen, that can happen in those breakout spaces. Here, this is our conference room at Center School. But part of that feeding that professional growth for our educators in turn impacts the quality of program that we have. So this is something that would most certainly continue for us.
And I just want to add to that that piece, Lauren, that just as we talk about learning happening everywhere, we similarly can feel that professional learning for teachers can happen in many, many places. It doesn't have to necessarily be a special room. So, for example, when students go to specials like art, music, PE, there are no kids in the classroom. So a teacher, several teachers could come together and work within one teacher's classroom space. After school hours, there's all sorts of spaces available. Outside of lunches, for example, the cafeteria could be used for professional learning. And so we know in working with the architects that we're thinking about professional learning as happening within the building, not necessarily in a room. And I just wanted to add that piece. We also know that our buildings belong to the community. And one of the things that we are excited about doing is being able to have the building easily accessed by outside users, by outside community groups, both during the school year and during the summer, for example. Having a space that can be sectioned off so that the community members can easily have access to the building without necessarily having the entire building, as you saw when you walked in here tonight, open to the entire building. And so that's something else that we've been talking about, being able to offer access to some of these programs within the school day, but also outside of the school day.
So here's an example when we talk about some flex space. Right now, health travels to our first grade classrooms. And we do need space. We had a guest parent working with children on the stop, drop, roll, and cover. Cover might be new for you. As well as working on a relay on how you would dial 911. And our teacher sets that up intentionally on a relay, because then at the end, are you able to clearly state your name, your emergency, and dial the number? And that, because your adrenaline in a real situation would be quite heightened. So when we talk about flex space in the design, you'll see if we needed that space to become a classroom, it has the option to do so. It has the size, the capability to do so. Here's an example of an all-school meeting. We congregate as a school. This is a community event. We currently congregate in our gymnasium. We might have the opportunity to do so in a cafetorium where there's a bit of a stage. Right now, children perform at the same levels where they're sitting. It can be a little difficult for our young learners to differentiate themselves from the audience, to see, but it doesn't take away from our great community experience. Here's an example of our kindergarten bedtime stories. Wonderful event, a lot of volunteers for this. Children read with adults in classrooms, and then we gather in the gym. Families bring a blanket, we turn down the lights, and we read, and we use a document camera to project the story on the wall. So it's a great experience, and we look to continue those community building events.
So when we think about these multi-use or flex spaces, two of them that we think of quickly, the gymnasium and the cafetorium, are examples of spaces that are often used by the community. They're often used as these types of flex spaces. Another important component of them, they often generally serve us best when they have good connection to outdoor activity as well. So, for instance, this is the zone of the cafeteria. This is the zone of the gymnasium. Directly off the gymnasium, hard surface play area leading to outdoor play lawn. Similarly, cafeteria to an outdoor hard surface skate area that then leads out to play lawn. So students can move easily from activities within the building, through the skin of the building, to appropriate outdoor areas, and all doing so without having to do any cross-trafficking with any of the circulation of vehicular movements throughout the campus, which is very important in terms of student safety for children of this age group. But it's back to that issue of opportunity for exploration of the outdoor component of campus as learning environment, outdoor component of campus as extension of the classroom. This site has wetlands throughout it, which afford really nice opportunities for exploration, for study, for science, for mathematics. All these things can be incorporated to activities that support what happens in the classroom as well as outdoor throughout the campus itself.
So here are some examples of how we use outdoor space at an early childhood center. This is an example of a parachute. This is field day. We also use it during physical education classes. Wonderful, fun, great activity. We also look at what's growing around us. Right now at Central School, we're a little limited in terms of what's growing around us, but yet we reach out there, see this class had been studying ferns. Here's another example. We have children writing outside. These children went to the common, and they're observing a tree. What do you notice? How has it changed through the seasons? We're working on descriptive vocabulary. So you can see them grouped with the teacher and then working, drawing and sketching and writing about a tree. We would love to expand these opportunities, and the site will have a slew of them for us to just enhance these outdoor activities.
So what we'd like to do at this point is share with you a little bit about the organization of the campus, the outdoor play areas, the outdoor learning environment, and we have this modeling of the facility. We're a couple hundred feet above it, so we're either in a balloon or we all have our wings and we're flying over the building. But if we come down to grade level, you can get a sense of the entry drive and how the building might be seated. And as I said, circulation on this campus is organized discreetly from pedestrian, bicycle traffic, etc. Throughout it. So very, very much with safety in mind in terms of its organization. The approach to the main entrance point to the building, You can see a parent drop-off loop and entrance point to the facility. This area over here is actually the extension of the Early Childhood Center, so an opportunity for pre-K families to have their students received directly into that space, outdoor learning area associated with, and then directly outside it, opportunities for outdoor play, recreation. Again, up in the air, this view from the southwest corner of the site, and then coming around to the northern side of the site, this is gymnasium, that connection to outdoor hard surface play area and out into the landscape field area as example of how the building is organized and situated relative to those connections. This loop road actually is for buses only, so the opportunity to queue a number of buses at a time, so students could easily be offloaded in the morning or out to their buses for dismissal after hours, separated and bifurcated from those drop-off activities of parents, so that we have a clean distribution, but everybody in terms of arrival arrives at that same entrance node where administration is kind of the center pin of it. So that exterior space and organization, as Superintendent McLeod offered earlier, this is an opportunity to think about how the community utilizes the building, how the community has opportunity to come to the building and be part of it afterwards.
And that's something at our level, we are really looking to build those strong connections with family and with the community. Children at this age, they're gone for a long time. Often at the beginning of the year, their backpack is stuffed more than when they bring it on vacation and they don't know when they're going home. So it's important until now they can rattle off their routine and they know they're quite comfortable in their setting. But this is very important to have that homeschool connection and have it be a welcoming environment where we can also support families. Something that was in the Flex spaces, in addition to some of those areas, was a family resource center. We look for an area to have registrations when families are coming in. For those of you that have experienced that at Center School, it's a little challenging. It's not necessarily the most welcome or confidential environment. We also look for an area to host parent education to help teach more about responsive classrooms, how to support your developing mathematician, and having opportunities and space to do that. I've recently met with the town social worker, and we would love to build that town community relation and come in and have programs for parents, area preschool providers. There's just so much opportunity that we really look to expand and build those connections.
So those connections can also extend to the community for after hours use of the building. Superintendent McLeod touched earlier on the idea of this building and its organization. To come to this space, which is an important meeting space for the community, much of the building has to be open so that access can be allowed through it. The organization of this building is different. This first floor plan, this is that main entrance point found off of the parent drop-off loop that you saw in the site plan. This entry point is that bus drop-off loop, and as I had mentioned earlier, it all kind of comes together here on the main street, if you will, in the heart of the building. Administration occupies this zone. But these spaces, cafetorium, gymnasium, those are opportunities for community use after hours. And you see with these strong red bars, the opportunity to basically lock off those educational corridors so that these more public functions can have use after hours. And they have attendant toilet core facilities associated with them. They would have appropriate storage facilities associated with them, and they would have that type of access for the public for full utilization after hours. On the second floor level, similarly, the Family Resource Center that was just touched on, as well as the library space, the IMC, these can be accessed via stair tower and elevator core. But likewise, they can fully be separated from those educational wings as they move off from this kind of core portion of the building. So it's really this diagram again coming back, and it's this idea of what is the organization that we see in the building, how might it be interpreted by a child, but then how well does that fit with the goals, with the district mission statement, and other components that we've heard from the educators as a design team. So that's something that we're very pleased to have had the opportunity to this point in the design to avail ourselves to, but also looking forward in terms of, we have a long way to go in terms of schematic design, design development of this building to kind of really flesh out a building. And we look forward to kind of a continued dialogue between the educators and our team in terms of trying to find that realized building.
And so we just wanted to bring you back to the vision that we began with, that the educational program of the current project is to provide the early childhood structure, the ability to house all preschool through first grade. We just wanted to reinforce that vision for this project because it's something that we've been articulating all along. And it's something that we know that it's very important to the community to understand this vision. So we can't say it enough so that people understand that this is an early childhood program in a structure that will be built to house that population for the long term. We have to remember that we're building, you know, lower water fountains and smaller toilets and all of the things that go into an early childhood center, and the design components are purposely being done for a long-term vision of housing our youngest learners in that space. So we wanted to finish with that very important comment and then open it up to questions. So we have to do a pause in education to allow people to think about, there was a lot coming at you. And thank you to HCAM. We know that this is being filmed, so yep. For people who were not able to come tonight, they can also be able to listen to it. Thank you.
Hi. I just have a structural question. With the bathrooms for the preschoolers, are there going to be bathrooms in their classrooms, or are they where? I just couldn't see it on the diagram.
Sure.
Okay. So do you want to talk to that?
Yeah. Each of the classrooms, preschool and kindergarten, would have its own toilet core within the classroom wing itself. The first grade classrooms don't have a toilet within their core, but they have a separate toilet core in the proximity of their wing.
That's an important question.
Yeah.
So right now we have one kindergarten classroom that has a bathroom. It's much sought after. So the fact it interrupts learning. When you have children in and out, you're kicking your whole class to the bathroom. So the fact that it can happen fluidly as you're instructing, it will have more time on learning for students.
And independence, right? Mm-hmm. Building independent skills. Currently the preschool has one toilet with a little stool, and requires that the child be accompanied by a paraprofessional, every child, every time. So imagine the amount of time that's taking up a paraprofessional's time, so, yeah.
I can offer, as educational designers, we often hear from educators the time it takes for those smaller legs to make it 40, 50 yards down the hallway. So having it within the classroom environment is very helpful in terms of facilitating that time and learning and making sure that the students have as much exposure to what they're supposed to within the classroom environment as possible. Other questions?
As far as the setting, to me it seems like it's almost the opposite of what Center School is. Center School is on the town common, it's close to the road, there's a really close interaction between the community and the town and the school. And this one is set back a little bit, and maybe it's more secure because you can see people going in and out a little bit easier. But is there a way to reach a middle ground with those wetlands where we're not just seeing a road and a grove of trees and we know the building is back there somewhere?
Yeah. We have a real challenge relative to the disposition of the wetlands relative to the actual site. So all along the roadway is actually a pretty heavy
tree line.
Well, actually, more than that, this very faint, this blue line through here,
yeah,
is actually edge of wetlands.
Yeah.
So that is something that we are actually, at this point, that's a 50-foot buffer, and then there's a 100-foot buffer out from that. That's really our target. So that entire kind of edge of roadway is something where our access point, which is fortunate, falls between two wetland zones. So actually trying to get kind of an announcement of the building on the roadway is going to be a real challenge for this site. That said, one of the thought processes that we had as a design team was this, the idea of kind of wonderment of a young learner coming to kind of a space in the woods, if you will, a clearing in the woods where all these educational activities happen. And the opportunity to have the exploration of that natural environment be part of that educational opportunity. So it is different than the existing center school, but we think it has some really spectacular opportunities as well in terms of what it can offer the students.
Just a quick follow-up. Would there ever be an opportunity, not necessarily with this project, but to build like a nature trail or boardwalk through those wetlands and kind of have it as like a learning tool for children and maybe hook it up to Center Trail or something?
Well, one connection that I can point here, this is EMC Park. Mm-hmm. So one thing that has to be developed as part of a second means of egress from the site is this. It's not a roadway per se, but it's a pathway. That would make a wonderful point of entry for bicycles kind of coming from the north down through EMC and then down into the site as an example. But also kind of the shared resource, an opportunity to kind of build upon a resource within the community that currently exists. We can see it as an opportunity to help support the campus on evenings where there's special events, where possibly there's a large gathering in the cafeteria, where you might have a couple hundred parents coming, the opportunity to utilize the parking area of EMC Park and share that kind of back and forth between the two, we think is a real exciting possibility. The remainder of the site as it moves its way down, not depicted here, but there's opportunity for continuation of trailways through that site and potential connection to other parcels of property that are further south outside of this project. Those types of developments are not shown here, they're not made part of our development, but those are real opportunities for the future.
Can you talk a little bit about the emergency exit procedures when you think about all that's happening and all the schools and Sandy Hook and things like that? Can you talk about the layout and how?
Sure. Yeah, probably easiest in two ways. Well, site plan's a good one. Let me start there, actually, while I have it out here. Security for schools happens in two ways. One's active security, meaning supported by camera or other types of support, if you will. The other is passive, and it's the opportunity to passively be able to observe your surroundings and understand, is there something out of whack in terms of what's being seen? So as we mentioned, this kind of core knuckle point in the building is that of administration. So administration has a tremendous opportunity for that type of passive observation of this main entrance road, this drop-off, if you will, in this zone. Similarly, we will have administrative staff as part of the pre-K program at this prow of the building as well. Those are two, I would suggest, significant improvements over the current environment in terms of that type of passive observation. In terms of active observation, we still have a ways to go in terms of design development and other decisions, but that will be something on the table for the Elementary School Building Committee in terms of what level of introduction of active types of surveillance do we want, in terms of camera systems, in terms of infrastructure to support it. And those are all things that are part and parcel of schools as we think about them today, particularly in light of some of those events that you just touched on. In terms of the interior environment, if I can grab a first floor plan, there it is. Jed, do you want to talk a little bit about the scenario as you come in?
Yeah, so the way that it's designed now, we do talk about multiple, we're talking about a separate car drop-off area and a bus drop-off area. Really, that only happens when buses are dropping off and parents are dropping off. Once the drop-off has done, the building intents, all of the other entrances are kind of locked, and the only entrance point is through the main entrance, which is the one off of the car drop-off area that's close to the administration wing. So what would happen is you would come and you would get buzzed into the vestibule. You would not be allowed access into the school proper. You'd have to come into the main office area itself and get registered, get badged in before you're released out to, say, if you're a mystery reader going to a classroom, you would have to come in, sign in, get a pass, get a badge, and then you could be off and released into the school.
So that sequence that Judd touches on takes advantage of kind of both layers of active and passive security measures. So for instance, somebody coming to the skin of the building, working their way up the sidewalk, this is administration, and through passive just observation of who's coming and going, a good opportunity to see people at distance, to be able to see people on campus at distance away from the building. As Judd indicated, all doors during the course of the day, once the students are loaded into the building, are locked. And the main entrance point to the facility and the only available entrance point is the main entrance to the facility. That door is locked. And it takes advantage of active security where you have kind of a typical buzzer camera system so that the person buzzes into the office, a screenshot of who it is there. Staff within can make the determination, yes, this is a parent, this is a friend, this is somebody that is known to this school community. They're then allowed into the vestibule. And as Judd indicated, this second set of doors, which is needed when you're loading children in, they would be open at that time, at this point are secured. So that a person who's buzzed into the vestibule then turns to the right and comes into the office area, where again, the idea of badging, signing in, understanding where they're going in the building, what activity they're there to support, is all known, and then that person out into the facility.
If I could add to the piece about the active, the preparation is another big key when we talk about active piece of this. And so under preparation, we really have two areas. We have communication and we have practice. And so practicing evacuation drills is something that we're doing all the time, whether it be through our fire drills or our evacuation drills. And so children on the second floor, for example, practice frequently, quickly getting out of the building for different reasons. But the communication piece is something new to us, and it's something that we've been widely training across the district this year with our new enhanced lockdown procedures. And the idea being that direct communication is happening to all of these teachers in the classrooms in the event that there's something going on, mm-hmm. something critical. They can make decisions. And when you look at this design, this is an exit, this is an exit, this is an exit. Teachers are informed on an ongoing basis. It's no longer lockdown, be quiet, right? Mm-hmm. Lockdown, intruder in the building, this is where they are. Now I'm a teacher in that corner, guess what I'm gonna do with my kids, right? And they've practiced evacuating the building in a line, and they can do it really quickly. How long does it take you to evacuate your building?
Well, there are times that we purposely block off exits to say this one's not available, find another route out. So that might take us a minute longer, but we're safe, we're orderly, we're outside in less than 5 minutes, less than 4 minutes usually. But we intentionally, but also calmly, and we do vary, and we work with the fire department on that because we need to be able to be flexible should a situation occur where something is unavailable to you with that. And part of that goes into the training. We practice weather drills. If there was a tornado coming, where do we go, how do we prepare, and how do we position ourselves? We have evacuation drills, we have fire drills. So it's part of the course of how we practice and how we share that with children, goes into how they respond. Something else that we also work on with staff is noticing what's different. If someone has a real problem and doesn't want to get buzzed in, we're not going to buzz them in. Doesn't matter that you're you know, Mary's mother and you're upset, she forgot something, if you're in an emotional state right now that's elevated, leave it there. We'll get it to her. So it's training staff what's different, what's acceptable. And for those of you that come to school, even though we know you, hi, who are you here for? What's your child's name? We regularly ask that, and that's part of what we do, to check in. And the tailgating where I am not going to let you in, I have to shut the door, you have to check in. We are really mindful of noticing what's typical and what's atypical. Our school resource officer is a familiar face at our school, so that children are comfortable and they see that. And also when the car is there and he's there, parents see that. It's a deterrent. So it's not only for the middle school, high school level, but it's securing all of our buildings. Our doors are locked. We have fob access that we can get in and out quickly if we need to. We can deactivate them if they're lost or missing. Over the summer, our buildings will have a double entry system installed throughout the district now, so you are sure as we build this that's something that we're mindful of. And even, you'll enjoy this discussion, I know Judd was there, we talked about windows and having it so that you cannot see in the bottom. We went back quite a bit for this because we do not want floor length windows. We want some privacy. We want some space where you can't see who's down there low. So we came to an agreement of what that would be. But I was very mindful of thinking that we don't want full access. We want light in. How do we balance that out? But that's on our minds as well.
Speaking of that, so away from emergency procedures, but just in terms of windows and allowing natural light to come into the building, I saw fairly, they look like narrow windows than I would expect, but I also heard you want to utilize wall space, so I think there's a balance there. Mm-hmm. Are you still able to open the windows to be able to get fresh air in instead of just having a completely controlled environment, yep, like a corporation? Are you able?
No, absolutely. It's a great question, and yeah, it's something that we incorporate into each of our designs. These are highly efficient buildings that do rely tremendously on mechanical ventilation, etc. That said, nothing better than being able to open a window and have natural ventilation. An open window has to be a screened window. Mm-hmm. So those are the layers that we think of. We also think about size of window unit. The window units that were shown in the model, they're about a 3 foot wide unit. We can comfortably go wider in terms of the lifting requirement for a teacher being able to operate it easily or students to be able to assist. But one thing that we were thinking about when we first pass at kind of creating a skin of the building was to think about what's the driver from the inside? What are some of the most important requirements of the classroom environment? And that ability of pinup space, if you walk into any early childhood setting, the amount of visual information that's available and needed to be mounted on the surfaces really dictates a desire to have as much wall surface as possible while getting in natural light, views to the exterior, ventilation, all those other things. In terms of, are we stuck with what we have? Absolutely not. And this is, again, I'd like to emphasize where we are in the design process. We are pre-schematic at this point. We still have the schematic design process to make our way through, design development, and then into construction documentation. So there will be a lot of conversation in the community. There will be a lot of conversation with the elementary school building committee in terms of those types of decision points going forward.
And when we look at wall space, if we think of the child's height and what's helpful to them, maybe that's the only place to hang the alphabet, but it's really far from them. Mm-hmm. We'd like it at a place that's accessible. You could go up, show me where L is. Okay, now what is the next letter? To be able to touch and manipulate and bring that in, make it interactive. Mm-hmm. So it's not just wallpaper up high.
Right. And you have to balance too much stuff on the wall,
right,
too.
Right, it's overstimulating. Exactly.
Yeah.
Jean had a question.
Oh, Jean.
Sorry, going back to the outside diagram, or the building diagram, and while you're getting there, just if it were necessary, could the windows be used as an emergency exit as well? Mm-hmm. If you had to go through the
window? If they're screened, that could be tricky. I don't know about how easily the screens would be removed, again, from a security point of view, getting into the building, so
yeah.
I don't know.
When we speak about egress requirements for a facility like this, we typically do not think of the windows as part of that egress requirement. It's typically through stair towers, through doorways, through corridor spaces that are designed specifically for horizontal exit. Certainly the window sills, because of the age of the children here, want to be lower. So I guess in an emergency, through a window is a possibility. Screening is something that is typically outside of the operational, so that would have to be either pushed out, kicked out. It's possible in an emergency, certainly could happen. Not really the not really what we're designing for when we're thinking about egress calculation.
Okay, thank you. So my real question about this is, can you tell me how many? It looks like the loop in the front is the car parent drop-off.
Yes.
Is in the front of the building, the shorter one. So do you know approximately how many cars you can fit in that whole loop, and how that compares to what the daily drop-off is at the center school or the Hamlet school, for example? And the reason that I'm asking is, you know, the lesson I think that we clearly learned from the middle school and the high school is there is not enough on-site place for parents to line up, and it backs the traffic up into the street. So to the extent we can minimize that, I'm just curious how many cars can fit in that loop and not on the street.
I don't know if I have that number across the face. Was it in the 20s, Judd?
Yeah, 20, maybe 25. But I still thought the intent is that people coming for drop-off would park and walk their kids in?
No, for preschool.
For preschool.
But something, this is a wide lane. There's a bus lane that will go right back to the buses. So it's three lanes wide. I think they planned for that, Gene, so the busing can separate from the parent traffic. So the parents could queue in from here all the way down while buses can still pass and access the bus loop.
We also have, this is meant for parent overflow parking. Teachers will be parking back here. So if it got to a point where, and as you know, the intent is to have valet drop off, of course. So parents are not getting out of their cars. So they can quickly have children disembark and continue on their way. But if for some reason they needed to come into the building, then they wouldn't be stopping their car there and parking. They would be expected to park and enter the building. And we know from the way that we're doing this, unlike the high school, the way that we're doing this at the Hopkins School, the end, we will be next year, the Elmwood School, and at Center School, is it's very efficient. Mm-hmm. And so even if there are quite a few cars parked or lined up, it does move pretty quickly along.
And we would stagger our preschool times as we have now, so that preschoolers, they cannot participate in the valet system. It's hard to unbuckle and get out, so they would most certainly need to be parked and handheld and walk in to the preschool entrance. So timing would be different of the start and end days time, so that we're not competing for traffic.
Mm-hmm. And I think while kids are getting out, you're right that the traffic flows fairly quickly. If you go to Hopkins at pickup time, the challenge is while the parents are waiting.
Everybody wants to be at the end of the day.
In the morning, I think it's probably less of a concern than the afternoon. So I don't want to bog us down in that, but just to give that some extra consideration as the plans continue to develop. So whatever we can do to make sure we keep traffic off the Main Street.
How long is this road? I mean, that might add some perspective. And to think that we have a separate bus lane. Right. Do you remember how long? Sorry, that one I don't remember.
Probably it's 400 to 600
feet into the Y.
Yeah.
It's the same challenge at Elmwood School in the morning as well. You know, there's probably 40 or 50 cars that are lined up, you know, and it comes out to Elm Street.
Yes.
And that's just a public safety issue because it's a narrow road, you know, you have cars passing.
Yes,
you
know, you're right.
God forbid a kid gets out or something, and all that's going on.
So we have addressed that for next year. You're absolutely right. It's a safety concern that was brought to my attention. I've been working with police and fire department on that issue as well as the principal. So that the cars will, next year, the cars will loop around the building. And again, parents will not be able to get out of their cars, but as long as they stay in, the fire chief was fine with that, because it is an emergency loop. But they'll go around, that will keep the cars off of the Elmwood, off of that road, which is, as you say, two lanes. Give it a snowbank, and there's no way you're getting past there. So our goal is to get, when we looked at getting that line all the way around the back of the building and then looping back out, there shouldn't be that problem. Mm-hmm. At least it's going to help. You're right.
I actually have two unrelated questions, and my first one is kind of related to the windows. I know I've been in one of those center school classrooms with all the windows, and on a sunny day, it just feels like it bakes the classroom. No air conditioning, right?
We haven't fully decided that. Do we have an air conditioned base?
No, we haven't talked about it, but we probably assume it will be partially air conditioned. There'll be certain spaces that, let's say, are used throughout the year, probably would get air conditioned. And then usually what we do is we look at bidding out alternates maybe for a full air conditioning system, just depending upon where the prices come in.
And that's something that I brought up, and they talked about different types of glass and systems, because some of the rooms at center seem to act as a hot house.
Yeah.
So looking at where the sun is and how the material that's used in those areas would differ so that we don't have that problem.
Okay.
There's a lot of stuff they do with glazing now. Like when we design this, in our specification, we'll say if it's a west-facing window, it's going to get this type of glazing. If it's a north-facing window, it's going to get this type of glazing, all helping the solar transmission that would occur there.
Yeah.
And the one thing that's nice about this plant is actually oriented, you know, north-south. So this is the northern section of the building. The main classroom wing is running east-west, so it's getting most of its light is coming from the direction that we want it to come in. It's not coming directly in.
Okay. My second question was related to the slide that showed the different special ed areas.
Mm-hmm.
I noticed you had two classroom communities. Is one first grade and one second, one kindergarten and one first grade?
No, on the floor plan there, like on that floor plan, that's the first floor. So in this zone, these are both kindergarten.
Okay.
First grade is on the upper floor.
Because on the sped slide, I felt like the second floor rooms had those pods and the first floor rooms didn't.
Mm-hmm.
Or maybe they weren't circled, so I was wondering what the reasoning was for that.
Mm-hmm.
It's primarily because the kindergarten classrooms are larger than the first grade classrooms.
Okay.
So they're about 1,200 square feet.
Yeah.
First grade classrooms are about 950 square feet. So we can maintain the same structural grid of the classroom.
Yeah.
But on the upper floor where there's a smaller classroom, they can have the extra space to put in some of those other.
And are those similar to like at Hopkins, the pod idea?
Well, I think the breakout space in between, is that what you're referring to?
They do have and it is between two classrooms, but they have pods. It's like a glorified closet.
So it's not
a desk in it, right?
So every classroom doesn't have a pod, but in the neighborhood there is a small group breakout space that's in close proximity.
Okay.
So whereas Hopkins, I think almost every class has one, or
between
every two classes. Right, so ours, it's more of a neighborhood.
Okay.
And Lauren, correct me if I'm wrong, but I know that you had talked about having doors here and here.
Right.
So am I correct?
Yes. So that speaks to the egress, having two access and entrance points for the classroom, but also for the flexible grouping. We really don't want just the hallway door to promote flexible grouping. We want to be able to open a door between classrooms and students move in and out.
It's also a great safety feature, what you said that about the egress.
Yeah.
You know, you talked a little bit about co-teaching and the spatial constraints, and I wondered if
it was the vision of the new school was to expand co-teaching into more classrooms.
So the vision for co-teaching is that if we're doing a good job of early intervention, there'll be less need for co-teaching in the K-1 building because we will have fewer kids who have special education needs because we will be catching them early. However, Lauren had tried a wonderful model this year that was co-teaching that included a reading specialist, so a non-special education co-teaching model, where students coming in, having been screened through the literacy assessments, who maybe didn't have advanced illiteracy skills, maybe a little bit behind where we would want them to be, placed in a classroom with a general education teacher and a reading specialist teacher working all day long, having additional literacy intervention, and it's been widely successful. So to answer your question, the vision is that we're not going to need to increase that program because we'll be able to meet the needs much earlier and reduce the numbers.
I just have a 2-year-old, so I don't know a lot about preschool yet, but what are the impacts of having a preschool attached to a kindergarten first grade building? Are the hours going to be the same, and are people paying the tuition into the preschool, whereas the rest of it's just fully public?
So we would vary the times just to alleviate the traffic so that arrival and dismissal is different. The preschool, the main purpose of our preschool program is to educate children with special needs. Once children are 3 years of age, it's the public school's responsibility to educate them. We do round out those classes and build them with community peer partners, so they do pay tuition, and that would continue. Having the preschool within a K-1 building has significant benefits. You have sharing of staff, therapy spaces, professional development. Right now, preschool is in middle school. They feel a bit like an island. In terms of staff meetings and planning, middle school staff meeting topics, preschool, it's not necessarily meshing because it's completely different worlds. We see significant benefits with that. But preschool will have its wing, as we talked about, neighborhoods. So preschoolers are not going to have full reign of the building. We looked at proximity and their little legs moving to their therapy areas, because we do not want to lose valuable time getting from one end of the building to the other, or you know what, that would be their therapy, walking there and back because it takes so long. Ideally, if we have a storyteller in, will they be invited? Of course they will. Right now, those enrichment opportunities are not to be had because it's just not an appropriate match. So we do see significant benefits. And also our first graders, kindergartners that are developing wonderful skills, how great is it that they could be a peer model, a guest reader in a preschool class? Makes them feel pretty proud, and we see some great things with that.
And one less transition.
Yes.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And something else that we see a benefit is right now we have high school students who participate in apprenticeships. They come to center, they park, find a place to park, come in and work with students. Having the closer proximity to the high school, we could see that program expanding, where we have future educators working with our teachers and our students. So that's a benefit of having the location here near the high school.
Just out of curiosity, I heard you correct yourself a couple of times about the cafetorium. Mm-hmm. Why the linguistic choice? Is there a difference between
yes.
a cafetorium and a cafeteria that I don't know?
Sorry for my resistance to kind of accept the funny
well,
word.
Well, I think we all might have that, so I was wondering why the linguistic choice on that.
This is, and it's listed here as a cafeteria. You know, that's kind of what we like it as. So this space, cafeteria,
is plural? What is that?
yeah, that's singular, actually. Cafetorium is recognizing that it has an additional function that it can provide, and that's what an auditorium might also provide. And so it has an adjoining music classroom, which has a movable partition in this wall, which is an acoustical, movable hard wall surface, typically left in the closed position so that the music classroom can operate while the cafeteria is doing its dining functions. But for after-hours events, for special presentations, for the guest readers coming in, for those types of presentations, it's actually raised, so it's a platform level.
So it's a dual space.
It's a dual space. Okay. Thank you. And more easily said than cafeteria. So maybe we'll go there.
So okay. So that said, I hadn't noticed that there's no official auditorium space.
Correct.
And I know some of the feedback from some of the forums were making sure that acoustically it supports that. So those are things that I have voiced when we've met, making sure that it can be divided, the acoustics support that, so music functions as it should.
Better than the gym.
Oh yeah.
That we use it center.
Right, exactly. But it's important to have a raised surface for these children. I mean, imagine some of those Reader's Theater presentations or some of our other first grade nights that you attend, to have students just feel so important about being on stage and you're here. I mean, it just adds to, brings it to another level.
Mr. Markey, I see that we're almost at 8:30. I don't know if you want to close the forum or?
Yeah, sure. Does anybody else have any other feedback or questions?
thank you all. I think you did a great job. Thanks for the great questions. We documented all the questions and answers too. Is Rob still here?
Oh, yes.
There you are. Rob, if you want to just remind people of the Facebook page and email and things like that.
Oh, right. Facebook.com/HopkintonEHSBC. And I think a lot of the faces in here are already a part of that. And then HopkintonSchoolProject.com. But please tell people. That's the biggest thing you can do for us, is to spread the word, share the page out, get people on board so we get more folks coming to these things, so that when we come to town meeting, this isn't a surprise to anybody, and everyone kind of has been along with us as we keep moving towards town meeting. And I'd also invite you to please, if you haven't already, sign the sign-in sheets, even if you've already done it at previous workshops. It helps us to know who's been here with us through the year. So thank you again for coming.
Yeah, thanks again, everybody, for coming. Those on the Elementary School Building Committee, we have our regular meeting starting over here at 8:30, so the rest of you are free to go. So, thanks.
You are always free to go, by the way. Thank you for not.
You're also free to go.
Yeah.